Do people see my PowerPoint slides?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Okay, all right. Okay. So anyway, I started off with the M63, which is Sunflower Galaxy, and I wanted to say that I picked up on starting to do a little bit of extra processing of my image, of my images, and so this is an original image of M63, which is in what Canis Venatici, I believe. And so anyway, I started using on Photoshop Elements a color curves feature, which all of you I think are well aware of. And so I found that I could really enhance these images and bring out a whole lot of more detail and maybe add the equivalent of maybe an hour's worth of exposure to increase the detail in the image. And so this is a close-up a screenshot of the Sunflower Galaxy. You know, aside from the fact that this is a grand design spiral, which is typical of many grand design spirals, I did a few other things. Well, here's an inverted picture in the negative of that same galaxy, which I've been doing. And this is the Hubble Space Telescope view. And here's the HST of the central portion of that galaxy. So this is a galaxy that's probably going to get the attention of Dr. Weiss at some time in the future, you know, assuming that they ever get around to this galaxy, because it's a great deal to learn from this. And I think it would be most interesting for them to do that kind of a very large study on many, many galaxies so they could acquire a statistically significant sample of galaxies to see how they compare in terms of their age, their star forming patterns, and so on and so forth. And talking about star forming patterns, this was a view of the galaxy in the Spitzer infrared telescope, which at this wavelength shows primarily clouds of interstellar dust and gas. And then in the opposite area of the electromagnetic spectrum, this is a view of that same galaxy with the Galax observatory satellite, which observes galaxies in the UV, which shows the distribution of young, very hot stars. And you can see that the galaxy really extends way out, not just in the obvious boundary of the periphery, but also there are strings of newly formed stars way out in the, you can see these are strings of young stars in the far outer reaches of the galaxy. Okay, so anyway, next object I was looking at is M64. I believe this is in Coma Berenice. This is known as the Black Eye Galaxy. And you can see that's because there's a very dense area of dust towards the center of the galaxy, which gives the thing appearance of a black eye. So this is therefore known as the Black Eye Galaxy. Here's a blown up view of that galaxy showing that the area of dust. You can actually see this visually through maybe a 10 or 12 inch telescope through an ordinary eyepiece. And so something really uniquely interesting to look at. There's the negative view. And so being it's a negative view, the area of dust is the lighter area here near the nucleus, and everything else is in the negative. Okay, so here we are back to the Hubble Space Telescope, and you can see just what a spectacular view of the central portion of the Black Eye Galaxy is, almost kind of look like flying over a city in an airplane as you're approaching an airport or something like that. It's really quite something. It's a view that could come out of a science fiction movie with special effects. Okay, well, here's a nice edge-on galaxy in Canis Venatici Onso. It's a called NGC 4244. And I brought this one up simply because we don't generally get a chance to see other kinds of edge-on galaxies other than the ones that are traditionally shown, like NGC 891 or NGC 4565. But this one was a nice, lesser known edge-on in Canis Venatici. Negative view. And here's a magnified screenshot of that same galaxy. Okay, here's a Hubble Space Telescope view of that same galaxy. And here we can actually, just like Dr. Weiss was saying, you know, can actually resolve these galaxies into individual stars and map their distribution and survey their various types and dominant colors. Okay, anyway, here's the classic edge-on galaxy that everybody sees in the publicity publications. There's NGC 4565 in, I believe it's Coma Berenice. And this one has a very prominent dust lane going through the center, along the center of the thickness of the disk. Negative view again. And here's a view that was taken by, I think, an intermediate size, maybe about 20 inch. And there's another galaxy off in the distance called 4567, I believe. And so, and then there are many other galaxies, smaller galaxies in the background, which you can also see. Okay, this one's interesting. This is an interacting pair of galaxies that are undergoing a collision. And you'll notice that the one of these galaxies has a kind of a tail stretching out. And for that reason, this galaxy pair is known as the MICE, or the catalog number is NGC 4676. And I believe, let's see, this is in Coma Berenice again. This was a galaxy that I had difficulties catching because it passed right over the zenith above my house at the time I was shooting. And sometimes I would lose tracking because on the altazimuth mount of the EV scope, because it had passed out of the range of the restricted areas that the telescope is not supposed to go to. So I magnified this image up to show the two interacting pairs. And of course the HST has taken here's a negative view. And the HST has taken a spectacular close-up of this colliding pair. And just to give you some idea of where these streamers come from, I managed to come up with a video of a computer simulation of this collision. There we go. And you can sort of see the streamers actually coming out of the collisions, and they're basically stars that are continuing on, almost kind of like they're being flung out by centrifugal forces. Okay, and there's what the merged galaxy should look like sometime in the distant future. I think Michael Cook said you had shot a picture of the Antennae Galaxies, which are a pair of colliding galaxies in Corvus. And you'll probably show a picture of that in your presentation as well. So I'm not gonna belabor this one too much, other than just to show you the raw image that I took. And then here's an enhanced view showing the streamers coming out of the collision. So where do these streamers come from? And I was able to find another computer simulation of this colliding pair, which is here. And it seems like these are streamers are coming from stars that have continued momentum beyond the collision and are being flung out from the galaxies as they collide and ultimately merge. Here's another pair of galaxies that are in an earlier stage of collision as they're still approaching each other and almost coming in contact. And here's a magnified view. It's a nice view of an early stage in the collision of galaxies. And here's a negative view. And here's an HST view of these two galaxies. So
it's NGC 4567.
4567.
And 68.
It's 68. Okay, thanks very much. Okay, there you go. Okay, so anyway, there's, for those of you who have EV scopes and are interested in pursuing these colliding galaxies, there's a couple of books that I recommend. One is this book called Cosmic Collisions, which is an atlas of HST pictures of colliding galaxies, and it's not an observer's guide. Unfortunately, it doesn't give you the coordinates of these objects, but you can take the catalog numbers off of the captions and look them up on the web, and then make your own observing list. Another book that I recommend, if you can find it, is this book, The ARP Atlas of Peculiar Galaxies. A Caltech astronomer by the name of Halton Arp in 1966 published a big atlas of galaxies with peculiar morphologies, and that became quite famous. And the original hard copy of the astrophysical journal that it was published in became a big collector's item and was oftentimes hard to get. Fortunately, about 2006, the publisher Woolman Bell, back in Richmond, Virginia, republished the atlas as an observer's guide, which includes the coordinates and pictures that are originally published, most of which were taken from, I believe, the 200-inch Palomar telescope.
All right, so this is NGC 4731. And I didn't have quite, I was going to plan on some more research on it, but it was in something I discovered just online about peculiar galaxies, odd-shaped galaxies, and that this one has supposedly been in a collision. I mean, kind of see a satellite flew through my picture too. So, but yeah, it's just amazing how some of these galaxies can get really deformed by collisions. And I've got this here, which I was trying to get the double bits of this, is NGC 5394 and 5395. And you can really see the colliding and just like what Ken was talking about, these collisions cause these big spiral arms, the stars to be spreading out. And this one appears to me to be a bigger galaxy colliding with another galaxy. And you can see the bigger one is more absorbing it. And at some point in time, you could just imagine the black holes merging. And I find these things becoming very interesting. Then I also have this one, which the big one, you can kind of see this big spiral there is 4618, NGC 4618. And this other one, which I believe this is another pair that's either merging or collided a little bit already from what I was understanding. This one's got, they both have odd shape from like a grand design spiral that you would think, but you could also see that at one point they probably were like that. Then I ran into these guys I thought were kind of interesting. And I don't know if it's the angle or just that these are really strangely shaped galaxies. This is NGC 4449. I mean, in some ways, it's like looks at pictures that I've seen of dwarf galaxies, but I don't really think it's, I don't know if it's one. I haven't got to the time to research it yet, but it's just such an odd shaped galaxy. It really caught my attention. And there's another one very similar to it here, which is NGC 4214. And I got another picture of it last night that I think might be a little better, a little longer run before the clouds came in and killed my camera shot. Just very interesting curves in the nucleus and just not what your mind thinks of when they think of galaxy pictures. And I think the last little thing I have, oh yeah, this guy. This galaxy, I guess, might just be that it's very faint. Because I think you can kind of see like hints of maybe that it is sort of like a spiral, grand spiral.
Yeah, it seems like there's more detail out there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can see, so I think like if I found a Hubble picture of this, this is 4395, that we would see more than that. But without it, you just see these, you know, this weird blob and these partial, I guess they're starburst areas in the arms, but it just had such a weird shape to it. From what I could gather, it caught my attention a lot.
Looks like an irregularly shaped barred spiral.
Yeah.
And then there are two areas which are typically known as H2 regions, which are areas of ionized hydrogen gas. So those typically are indeed areas of starburst star formation. And I know that there's some big ones, like in M33, there's a big area called NGC 604, actually has its own catalog number from M33 itself. But it's out in one of the outer spiral arms, just like what you see here.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that's exactly right, Ken. I think this probably is a real spiral. These are things I've started on, but I haven't really got to get into all my investigation to see what it maybe really looks like. But it
might be fun to apply a Photoshop curves enhancement on this thing and bring some contrast to this.
I actually did run it through a little bit to bring it up, but I think your idea too of using negative and also making one where I did try and tweak it to where it just looked good as an image and not necessarily just bringing out details. But I think the negative too might help to see these other spirals that may exist in there, just too faint for this. So yeah, that's about it. I do have these two guys are also colliding actually.
Yeah, those are neat. Yeah.
This is NGC 4302 and 4398, I believe. And they're on a collision course, and you do get a little dust lane in this vertical one. So it's like one that we're seeing edge on and one that we're seeing top down on my quest of colliding galaxies. And I have some of the same ones you already showed, so no point in bringing any of those up.
Okay, well, I've got just one to share. I like comets. This is C2020RY Atlas right here, where I was pointing. It's pretty faint. It's probably not going to get any brighter, but that's about the best.
That's pretty good. You can see the tail.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's neat.
Yeah. Up where I am, I'm getting a lot of fog. So I reckon it's drizzling lightly out there right now.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Sorry, Ed, which comet is this?
That's C2020R4. Atlas.
R4.
R4, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Is Atlas the system?
It wasn't in the catalog, so I had to get it from coordinates.
Okay.
When did you shoot this picture? Let's see.
The 12th. Okay. It was Wednesday, I believe.
Well, you might want to bring some Photoshop enhancement on through the curves.
I probably could bring that up.
Yeah, give that maneuver a try. It really actually it's really quite produced some pretty impressive results.
This was a PDF of the Atlas of Peculiar Galaxies.
Yes, the Caltech has the ARP Atlas posted on the internet, so you don't need to buy any books, although the books are helpful that I find.
Yeah, I'm just going to comment. It is out there. I just did a search when you're talking about it.
There's also another interesting catalog. It's done by it's a Russian catalog. By a fellow by the name of R.A. Vorontsov Vilyaminov. And that is also available on the internet as well. So something called the Morphologic Catalog of Galaxies, or the MGC. That's also available. I couldn't find any hard copies of it for sale on the used book market, but I did find it posted on the web. So, and then there's another book. I don't know if you can see it here very easily. This was published in 1992, and it's called the Hickson Atlas of Compact Groups of Galaxies. And it's not published any longer, but what it is, it's an atlas galaxy clusters and photographic atlas of galaxy clusters using early CCD technology. And there's actually even an Astronomical League division that is in which people are devoted to visually locating these groups. I haven't bothered yet to look for the Hickson catalog online. Copies of this atlas are available out there, although they run about a little over $100 a piece, and so that may not be within everybody's budget. I bought a copy way back in the early 90s, and so I got it for relatively less money. But that's another galaxy collection. I think the Astronomical League also has catalogs that are still available for galaxy clusters and the Higson group. They have an ARP galaxy section for people who want to visually locate the ARP catalog galaxies. So there's sort of a little community of colliding galaxy buffs out there who, you know, who whom I don't know if they have a group as such on the internet, but there are people out there who are interested in this kind of stuff, and there's a whole literature that is out there to support them.
I guess that's it. I thank you all very much for your contribution, and hope everyone enjoyed the presentation, and we'll do this again in June.